Hello, and welcome back to another episode of School Days, where we talk to creators behind the scenes, talking about their creative process. And also, we're going to learn a few things from them in a tutorial. So we're going to step right into it. What's up? We are here with my brother, Clay. Hey, Clay.
How's it going?
I'm good. We are excited to have you here, man. You are like one of those creators that from the get-go, I saw their work and I was just blown away. And just seeing you step from strength to strength, you know, it's just so, so incredible. Before we even jump into the whole creative process and you as a creator, I mean, you're in London now and obviously you're grounded. What has that been like?
Oh my God. Do you know what? Like, I think initially it was a little bit like it stirred the waters a little bit to kind of just realize that, oh, I'm actually stuck. but it's been really good for the creative process, to be honest, just like, putting together things that I probably wouldn't have had time normally to put together. So that's been good. But I love that, like, in this, like, season, so many things, like School Days was birthed, or like, you know, and stuff like that. So I think it's crazy how, like, it's sort of become this blessing.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah. I feel like in the season of, like, collective loss, like, many of us have been able to really thrive. Yeah. And grow and still push boundaries creatively and with amongst all the different limitations. You're a storyteller, you're a co-founder of Wind Collective, and you're also an influencer. And I'm sure there's some other things I'm missing, but how has it been balancing all of those different roles?
Honestly, like, I think you go through periods and seasons. And I think with the Wind Collective, we lived on the road for the last year, like nonstop travel. And so all of our creative projects and all of our storytelling worked in collaboration with the Wind Collective or wherever the Wind Collective was. So we were telling stories about a particular location. Now that's so different. As we've been working more with our clients and putting together briefs, it's more about the stories they want to tell and us enhancing those stories. My job on the creative angle of the Wind Collective's creative agency, is actually as a producer, director, writer, all of these things. It's a storyteller because I play different roles as per the project. Sometimes the project might not necessarily need a director, but then it needs like a producer to work on the step-by-step in the pre-production process. Other times I'm more active, especially if it's a story that I pitched, where I'll work as like a director or a writer, putting together shot list, script, things like this. And then the numbers for, as it relates to like influence, like that's a new thing to me. So I'm still navigating that. And like, to be honest, like just navigating that as like a content creator and trying to find my voice there and what's a story that I want to tell like personally. I think because that like content creator space is a personal brand, we're just looking at that and seeing what that's like. So this has been a very good season for like understanding that too. I'm not upset that I'm not traveling as much because I still have those other roles to fill, which are keeping me busy.
Yeah, you are definitely staying busy. And I think anyone who goes to your personal profile can see that. I mean, so guys, if you have not checked it out yet, you guys need to head over to Alive Like the Wind. So incredible content. And, you know, just visually arresting. And that's one thing that I found that really attracted me to Clay's work is that, you know, just that strength of the visual message. And so you talked about storytelling just a second ago. I want to kind of jump right into this whole thing of you and storytelling and really that at the heart of it, that's what you are, right?
Yeah, I think it's so beautiful because as a traveler and a storyteller, I think you find that these things, like, they have to coexist because you have a place that is made up of the stories of the people that live there. And I think often we go to a place and we'll go, all right, this is like, I've come here to experience this place. And I'm like, you can never, ever experience that place without experiencing its people. And even when you experience its people, like, there's so much depth and layer to it. So my job and also my passion is to go to a place and immediately try to get below the surface of that place by engaging with the people and telling the stories there. And I think what that creates actually is it reminds us that the only story that matters is actually the human story, you know? And we start to find similarities. It doesn't matter if people have different religions or if there are different races. And so you start to find like these similarities that exist within our stories. And I think that's where it's beautiful, you know, and that getting to share that with other people and inspiring other people to engage with their stories, to engage with their own story, and to engage with other stories, I think is the purpose.
Absolutely. Before we get into your tutorial, I remember, just a couple months ago seeing your project that you shot for Corona in Jamaica. And do you feel like your cultural influences also kind of help, drive some of the story narrative? Because your family's from Jamaica and Cayman Islands, correct?
Yeah. So now I'm becoming more passionate about telling stories of my heritage. To be honest, before that, I've kind of considered that like a private, sacred space. And so I'm not sure I felt vulnerable enough to like let people into those spaces. Now I realize actually that the original stories that we want to tell are going to be the stories that are particular to us. You can fight for originality, but actually you can't have originality without vulnerability. Like there is no one in the world like you. There's no one in the world with your particular story. And so if you start to explore those, where like for me, it's like looking into faith, or it's me like looking like into my background or my parents' stories, or like the Jamaica film, like a place that I'm from, or exploring that all over again. And so I think like when you start to embrace your own story, that's where you start finding originality. And so that's the reason for going back to Jamaica. And I was really excited to be able to go on that project. To be honest, it was an actual dream project to just be yourself. In a place that you love, in a place that you know, and also like for your story to matter within the context of the project. So that was really awesome.
Oh, amazing. And you even just talking about it, it just makes me want to be there right now. Yeah. And I think for many people seeing it, I think they would just transport it. So, I mean, with that said, I want you to transport us into your creative process and give us a bit more. I think we have so much to learn from you, and I just can't wait for you to share that with us. So feel free to jump into it and share your screen.
The first thing I want to share that's really important is what I believe are the elements of a visual story. So some of the things that I think are like important elements of a visual story. And of course, this is like a lot, this can be a lot more layered. These are just things that I think are like at least baseline, right? And so one of those things is like location. And when we talk about location, we're talking about the country, the setting. We're talking about, is that indoor? Is that outdoor? Things to consider, time of day, where does the sunrise? Where does the sunset? And these things are important because that's going to lead on to like technical as it relates to lighting, for example. And so how I tend to work on our locations, whether it's for a Wing Collective creative project or whether it's for our client, is to research that location and put together a mood board of that location. All right, second thing I would say is character. Often, and I love playing with this, I know a lot of people would probably prefer to be just themselves in photo, but I love the idea of like creating different moods or like working through it. Like, for example, we can see sort of in the background here a picture of Ashley and I. Now, most people will know, or a lot of people know, that Ashley and I are just friends. But in this photo, we've seen it reposted on these like Black Love pages and all this stuff, because at this moment we were like, okay, what's the persona that we want to share in this moment? And we see our storytelling as actual art and our photography is art as well. And so we're like, okay, what's the persona? What's the mood? What does this character repeatedly do? Because I think that's what builds character. Like, what is it that they repeatedly do? And then that will help us decide, okay, what are they wearing? What are they wearing? What are the props that they're using? Do we need... So what are the props that they're, is the audio going to be separate?
I will edit out any bit. Okay. So it does render a separate audio track, but I just work directly from the video file and then I'll separate audio at certain points that I need to.
Do you want me to start over that character bit?
To start over the character bit. Yeah.
Okay. So I think the second thing that we tend to look at is like character. Character is really important because it helps determine the persona or the mood of the piece, the video, the photo. I think with character, I simply define it as what does this person or what does this persona repeatedly do? And so that will help determine things like wardrobe or props. Another thing that's really important here is like plot storyline, which I think is probably one of, I mean, we could talk about that for ages. We could talk about, what's the beginning, middle, end of even a photo, or like a photo shoot session. Like that's endless, right? Like if you really want to go in there, like I'm not sure how long people actually spend on those mood boards. I'll let you into my personal process in a few, but how do we get our character from point A to point B? Is there conflict? Is there resolution? Like there's so much to go into it. And I think you have to approach those things differently. It relates to fan video script. Is this voiceover led? All of these things will help build the plot and the storyline. And then the last one that I think is an absolute essential is technical. I think showing up to a place to shoot and not thinking about like what lens you want. Like, do you need like a super wide lens? You know, are you shooting landscape? You know, are you going to be shooting like a close-up? Are you going to be shooting portraits? Do you need to use a prime lens? Like, how do you want to frame your subject? Like, if it's video, have you thought about sound? Are you pre-recording sound? Is there lighting? Is it natural lighting? Is it studio lighting? There's so much that goes into it. And it sounds overwhelming, but like, to be honest, it is a really fun process. It's something that I personally enjoy, actually, just because seeing your vision, like doing that beforehand and then seeing that vision come to life with the finished product is, wow, it's like absolutely mind-blowing. I'll share a little bit about these mood boards as it relates to like location and character, which is like the first thing that we sort of go to. So we start with the location. So obviously we do a Wing Collective trip every month or a few every month. And so the first thing we send out for our guests that are gonna be partaking in the photo shoot, is like a mood board. So for example, this is our Jamaica location mood board. So again, we start with location. We're like Jamaica, tropical landscapes, secret waterfalls, bustling markets, beaches, culture, music. And we start to bring together a mood board of what we think the adventure will look like. We draw that from Pinterest, we draw it from Instagram save option, we draw it from the internet, screenshots, and we'll bring this all in and put it in one place where we can kind of like, okay, we'll see everything. And then that will help us then determine, okay, what are the scenes that we're gonna to create within the context of this location. We'll move out of that and we'll go into, for example, what these character mood boards will look like. So for example, I've got this one here, which was for our Budapest mood board. There were two photo shoots that we held there. One was called Teen Spirit and the other was called Eden. So we look at things like Eden and we go, okay, our Eden shoot is at a secret ruins location. So again, we start with the location. Then that will help determine, okay, well, that location, what colors are there? You know, what colors will work well with what they're wearing? So then we start thinking about that character and we're going, all right, blending neutral sandy tones against overgrown brush. This earthy shoot is about life in the most odd places. You know, we decide, okay, what's the theme? And so we did the same with the Teen Spirit shoot. We can see it here. You see it start to be reflected in the photos. It's about an endless summer. It's California road trip retro meets casual skater vibes. It's picnics and bonfires, denim, floral. And we did that. We do that with every place. So we did that with Budapest. We'll do it with Sri Lanka. And that just helps us like create better or like stick to a theme. So we go here. We're like, okay, this is our safari shoot. And this is our like beach shoot. And what does that look like? So might be particular costumes. So with KK Beach, baby, we wanted, all right, this is about classic swimsuit summer. It's black and white bikini meets tropical island vibes. Think straw hats, flowing linen, sun, sand, palm trees, ocean blue. And so we sum up the location visually. And then we go, all right, what is that going to look like characteristically, you know, for you, you know? And then we start to give ideas of props and wardrobe, the same with the safari affair. I'll show you a Pinterest board of, excuse me a second. Here we go. So this is from a shoot we did last summer, actually, called French on the Prairie. And it was for a creative concept in the south of France. We wanted to embody boho chic and playing on smart lines with carefree spirit. And so again, we started with the location, but then we started to think, okay, what does this character look like, you know, like in modern, in like actual examples. So we started pulling from the internet. Pinterest is a really good tool for this, definitely, just because it's unlimited search and you're able to bring so much stuff in. And so we ended up looking at some locations particularly. So we see over here, like an image of a girl running through a lavender field. And I shot an image of Ashley that was really inspired by this image. And I have a few images that if I showed you from this, you would be able to go, okay, that is definitely within the setting of that. Again, we see things here like props. This girl is having a picnic on the ground. And so we're like, okay, what props do we need for that day to make this come alive? And so we start with the theme, we start with the location, we start with character. And I think those are very important elements to building a story. I would say the next thing that we do is going into our plot storyline, which is the great big beast. Because I think it's so interesting, because I think it's really important to think about the plot storyline. And a lot of people will think about it in the context of video. But again, it's super interesting, some more than others. Like I think Location, character, and technical is going to be more important for telling stories through photo, definitely. And if you're extra, like my friends and myself, like, we'll go, okay, let's think about plot storyline, you know, let's think about how we can, like, weave a storyline into this. What's the narrative that we want to tell? So, like, the famous train photo of Ashley and I are friends, and so we were like, okay, let's think about, like, the context of what we want to tell. We want to create this idea of, like, whimsical. Do you say whimsy? That's an
album. Whimsical. Whimsical, I think, yeah.
Yeah, so we wanted to be whimsical. We wanted to create, like, flowing, like, in the wind type vibes. And so we went on this train and it was, like, overcast. And we were like, okay, this wasn't what we set up for, but what's the story that we can tell given the setting? And so we went for a lot more moody, a story of love that we believe, like, we actually wrote a caption, even the caption tied into that, as it relates to, you know, can a boy and a girl be just friends, which is about Ashley and my story, which I thought was, like, really interesting and how you blend that in. And I think that's the thing. You can add stories to a post so that people know that there's a process behind the post. And so people know there's a process behind the post. And I think when you let people into that process, they're more grateful, they're more understanding of the photos that, or the art that you create. And so it's also helpful for, like, even stories or Instagram stories or sharing the behind the scenes of the process of this is how we created what we created. And it allows people to like be more engaged with the end product, I think. As it relates to video though, we go into a few things. So I'll just touch on character for video, character and mood. So this is a concept that we put together called Like a Girl with Saudi. And it's a series built around female empowerment and addressing the misconceptions of what it means to be a female in Saudi society. We had these themes that we wanted to go through, which I'll touch on in a second. But really, it started with the concept, you know? And then we started thinking about style. Again, this is probably a little bit more technical because we were like, okay, we want it to be like short documentary style, but we want it to be above the line, commercial quality, super cinematic, super glossy. We want it to feel like commercials, but they're actually documentaries. Then we started playing with things like color palettes and themes. So we go here and we go, all right, in the context of personal identity, struggle, achievement is one theme. We started looking at that. We go, all right, we want it in context of cultural norms and significance. And you can really start to see here that you start to visualize, even if you've not seen the film already, you start to see, okay, I kind of feel like I know what this is going to look like. And then in context of community and camaraderie, again, this is another thing. We start playing with the color palettes. And like these tools, like tools that you can use for this is like Photoshop is really good. Keynote, Canva. Canva is, if you feel like you're not, if you don't know like the technical aspects of Photoshop, Canva is really good for actually just finding templates and dragging parts in and out. It's really good for creating storyboards, and it's something that I use a lot for, as well as Keynote, which comes on your Mac, and Photoshop. And in context of Saudi country, landscape, city, location, again, you start to see like why these colors are important. So you're probably going to be shooting at sunrise or sunset because the colors are going to be softer, and lighting's going to be more beautiful. The desert is a natural, we're not leaving out the location. The desert is naturally brown. And so we're tying that into the colors. And so that's how we would approach something like visual or where we would start in terms of video. I think, again, this can be used for a photo too. If you start to think all of these have photos and it's just like, these are the photos that we think match these themes. And then also you can build your wardrobe and things out of the colors that you want to showcase on that day. So I think that's super important when you're thinking about location and character. Now, if we're thinking about plot, this is a lot more in depth. I'm just going to go in here. This is a brief that we did for Corona a while back. And so something like this is a lot deeper. This particular video. And then this is building out your video story. So we ask ourselves so many questions, the importance of like brainstorming, having like thought showers, like where you can get people around you and actually go like, all right, this is the idea that I want to portray. How can you make that possible? So in our brainstorm, we have a few storytellers. We also have a few guys that are like more technical that can actually say like what's possible, what's probably not, what do we have budget for, et cetera. So we start with the key elements of the story. For this particular story, there were three elements that we wanted to really convey. And that was human connection, timeless culture, and nature's power, right? Again, we start with the location. So the location's in Guatemala, Lake Atitlan. Guatemala, we start, what is this location known for? It's known for Mayan heritage, the land of mystery, legends, volcanoes, mystical lakes. We start bringing in what this idea of like this thing's gonna look like. What is it gonna look like? Really wanna paint a picture for the viewer, or in this case, the client, because they've never seen the story. So you need to make it clear as day for them, which is the importance of storyboarding. I think it can be for the client, or it can be for the viewer, or it can just be for yourself. I think it helps you tell a better, clearer story if you storyboarded it. So we started looking at secret locations that we wanted to shoot at. Locations that I believe like add to the story. And then our next thing is to do is to picture that story. So what's one way, if your whole story, again, this is video, but if your whole video story could sit within one picture, what would that look like? You know, one 4x5 Instagram like tile, like what is that going to look like? And so we're going, okay, for me, for example, we're like, all right, five friends sit atop a ridge sharing moments at golden hour with dramatic sweeping views of a smoking erupting volcano in the foreground. All of a sudden it's like, okay, wow. Like I know what this is going to look like. And you start to get like, wow, if you saw that, you would probably most likely, hopefully, click on it and want to watch it, right? And I think that's something to like to consider. Then we started going into what editorial themes we have. And so we started thinking, okay, what are the themes of this story? So we're going, all right, the rituals of the travel community, yoga, meditation, connection to nature, long lost local sanctuaries is a theme. So we start thinking, okay, what are the sanctuaries within Guatemala that we can look at? We're looking at this volcano, like it helps us to determine our location by understanding our themes. Heritage journeys is another thing. We see our Guatemalan characters transform by experiencing the mundane through the awe and the wonder of our visiting cast. Again, that's a story element that we want to tell. Stress-free habitats, sounds of decompression. All of these are themes that help us tell the story. Then we start breaking that story down into acts. And so we're going, all right, act one is about location establishment, the why. Establish our main character into the supporting character, Jonah and James. And throughout that, we're going, okay, we start with the location, we establish the character, we're going through the plot storyline, and within that plot storyline, we need them to experience some sort of conflict, right? And so they start here, they're in their location, and then towards the end, you see the conflict is they catch a local chicken bus to a southern city, but take the wrong bus. So I think that's super important to a storyline because we go, all right, you're trying to get from A to B. And within that, A to B, you might get to this point and you're going to experience conflict. Now, the role of the character and also the writer or the storyboarder, the director, is to figure out how that character manages that conflict so that they can continue their journey, right? Again, this is video and this is the importance of storyboarding, like seeing it all out in front of you and not just keeping it internally will also help you realize if it's a terrible idea. I think that's like realizing like, okay, this doesn't work. Again, we split act one into visuals. This is pretty visual heavy. We had a particular character, so we started to draw images of him from his page and bring those into the spot, into the space. Act two, we go through again, particular scenes of what act two is gonna look like. Act three, the same. Then we get to a really important part, which I think is super important for storytelling. And it's your first 3 seconds and your first 30 seconds. Mm-hmm. The first 3 seconds, super important in terms of keeping your audience like engaged. Like, and you want them to know, okay, why should they watch this? If your first 3 seconds is not gripping enough, you're not gonna have a good retention rate. People are gonna drop out, right? Mm-hmm. And so when we started, for example, with this video, the first 3 seconds, a dramatic score, introduces panning drone shots of a volcano erupting at dawn, skipping between close-ups of the main character as he meditates. Then we're thinking, how do we continue that momentum, that pace, or how do we change it if that's the story we want to tell within the first 30 seconds? Again, a good opportunity to keep your audience gripped. There's no point in just keeping them for the first shot and then they're like, okay, that was fun, and then they bounce off, right? So then we think about that, like, what does your first 3 seconds look like as a video creator or as a storyteller? But what does your first 30 seconds look like? Again, we put visuals together for that. This is for the client. And so they're looking at this and they're going, okay, they can imagine what that story is going to look like. Another thing that we do is we talk about how we change the pace throughout the video. We don't want a story that's flat. So we're like, okay, what techniques are we going to use in storytelling to change the pace within the video? So for example, we start with these dramatic, breathtaking views before introducing this mystical location and all things sensory, smells, tastes, like what is this character experiencing? As we start to introduce these characters though, we start to think about transformation. We start to think, okay, how do characters transform to suit multiple locations? How does a musical score drive the story? Are we using voiceover? Are there small amounts of natural dialogue? Like how do we interweave subplots into our characters? And so it sounds long, but honestly, it's just like about creating, like having your story set out in front of you in order to tell the most effective story. And this just helps you build in terms of the back end of your story. We start to imagine what our character might say, our main character. And so again, linking back to the story, and like I've written here, like something that Jonah might say. So I looked through his, because it was based on an actual person, it was easier to look through his Instagram profile. And I just saw a caption that said, "The path is the practice." And so that became the base for what I thought he would say. And so we start to put together this caption or the soundbite, sorry. It's like the path is the practice means it's never been about the destination. It means the road that we walk, this journey is your greatest teacher. Our stories are woven together throughout millennia and we stand on the shoulders of our fathers' fathers. On this search through their wise and ancient teachings, we are directed within and pointed back to our own wisdom. And as we lose ourselves in the search, we find that we are never alone. And so this is something that we know, our, we want to be voiceover led, but also we think, how does it link back to the story? How does it link back to this idea of mysticism and Mayan heritage in Guatemala? And so you start to see this idea of like the story being generational, and it's like Jonah will most likely go through a transformation if he allows himself to within the story, right? Mm-hmm. Then we start to think about sound design. Super important. I think most people think about the visuals of a story and they forget that you... one of the most effective ways to tell a story or to enhance a story is through sound. People think it's only 10% of the video, but it is actually 50% of the video. And so we start thinking, okay, what does the sound sound like? So mix of diegetic and local sounds. Diegetic is just a fancy word for saying like on the spot sound, like sound that you can actually hear going
Thanks
on.
Thanks for breaking that down.
Yeah. And so like, you know, the market, when they're in the market, can we hear the sound of the sellers? Like if they're in the fields, can we hear the sound of birds? Like can we, you know, like, creating sound that's the sound of the element that's on screen, that's being shown, you know? We think about what we want music to sound like, you know, like, so for example, for this, we were doing a collaboration between a local Guatemalan producer and a sound technician. And the music will develop and change throughout the piece. We start thinking about with sound as well, like voiceover versus a normal use of natural dialogue. Like the beauty about this is if you have all of these technical things sorted out, then it helps you prepare with what you need to bring on the day. So you just, I'm not gonna forget anything because again, I've storyboarded. I've listed out my location. I've listed out and I've brainstormed around that. I've gone through my character. What is that character? What's their transformation? What do they repeatedly do? I bring it back to plot and storyline. I start working through that act one, act two. I start visualizing that storyline. And because I've researched my location, I know what that's most likely gonna look like. I'm not gonna hope for a big mountain and then get there and realize that the place doesn't have mountains. You know, like, then I'm gonna get to four, which is like, again, technical, which I'll talk on a little bit in a second, the technical side of things. But again, we then have our audience takeaways, which is really important for us. I do this with photo, I do this with video. What is the story that this photo or this video is going to tell? So for example, this story was like, all right, journeys are better when taken together. Then it's pretty conclusive then that we don't want only one person on screen for the majority of the film because this journey is about people being together in a space. So we bring people back to these like key organizing questions or these like theses where like a travel destination is little without the people. Again, this film is about the people, and though it's including location, it's less about the location than it is about. So I mean, that I know that's probably a lot to take in, but this is how we storyboard.
So good.
So this particular brief we put together with a focus on like the technical aspects of filmmaking. And it was produced remotely with my old job, The Culture Trip. And actually for a filmmaker to create without me being present. So I needed to make the storyline super clear. I also needed to make the shots super clear and what lens they're using and things like this. So this is where you'll see this again, more technical, more for the video side. So I had the idea, which was, I want you to capture the interview in the B-roll footage of this particular artist who is doing a particular project in Lebanon. I talked about the themes. I want the conversation to detail his upbringing and his life as a child during the Civil War and life in post-Civil War Lebanon. And I want you to talk about his inspirations and motivations. Now, everything's like super drawn out because you don't know exactly necessarily how technical or how much your filmmaker might even use initiative. Maybe your filmmaker works really well as like directing on the spot, or maybe they need like particular direction. So I start breaking it down into shots. I'm like, shot one, this is gonna be a close-up of like our subject. We want it looking directly at the camera. Please frame this exactly as seen below. Action should be the same for both shots so we can cut in between shot one and shot two. Please shoot it on a tripod. I want it to be super still. I want that to be a mid shot. If talent is crossing their arms in the close-up, they should do the same in this shot. Then also, please use a tripod and frame all interviews, as a mid shot as shown below. Then I start breaking it down into camera settings. Use a flat picture profile, S-Log. Like for this particular project, we wanted it to be shot on a Sony A7S Mark II 4K at 30 frames per second on tripod with a lav mic. But then the tracking shots, we wanted it to be around Beirut, shot on stabilizer gimbal in 4K at 60 frames per second for movement sequences that are not in slow motion, B-roll shot at 60 FPS. Then again, we go through like video direction here. These are particular things that I can imagine. So I said, this video will be a mix of interview shots and B-roll with him walking around Beirut. So we go here. I want various angles, slow motion shots of Omar walking around Beirut. These can be shot from various perspectives, and above shot from a roof would be good if possible. So I start to draw visuals of what I want to see. I always, for a brief like this, I would ask my filmmaker to shoot more so that I have more to work with in the edit process. Again, we start to break it down with that. We start to break down our mix of close-up mid and wide shots of Omar whilst walking around Beirut next to his artwork. So again, we have these shots of the character within the context of the place, general view shots, and then we go to our interview. Maybe our filmmaker isn't skilled at interviewing, so we start to give them like questions that they can engage with our subject on. And so we go down here with questions, go through that. And it helps to tell the story, So we'll ask him, obviously introduce yourself, but like, tell us about what inspired you to create this particular installation. And so they'll record this interview and we'll use that voiceover and we'll bring that voiceover together. And as they tell their story, we'll piece it together, chop and bring everything together to tell the best story with the assets that we've brought in, which is another way to tell a story. I mean, sometimes we go into it knowing exactly what we're gonna get. Often we go into it like this, where we pitch a story hoping that we're going to get stuff back, but then it comes together in the post-production process. Mm-hmm. Logistics, like we just break down for the filmmaker, like where he lives, what he's available for, and technical things like release forms. Good. But yeah, I mean, that's just a lot of the ways in which we tell a story. Again, some of those are more technical. Maybe you don't need all of those because maybe you're not doing like client work or video work. But I think it's just as important to see how we can get things like, again, location, character, plot, and bringing good technique into how we create photos or how we create Instagram posts. I think it's art, right? And I think as because it is art, like we should definitely be treating it with that level of like depth and process. So
for content creators that are working by themselves, they don't have someone else, like a collaborator that they're working with. So they might be sometimes shooting themselves. What are some suggestions that you can offer them?
Yeah, so I think like, I know a lot of creators that work solo that turn up to a shoot and they're like, okay, again, I'm just gonna bring my tripod and my camera. But I think it's still important to go through that process because then you know things like, okay, what's gonna be the best lighting at this location? At what time of day do I need to be there? Like, again, what's the mood that I want to create? So I have a friend who is doing a job for a food company and she decides, all right, I want to create a picnic. I don't have anyone to shoot it with me, so I'm going to go shoot it myself. She takes her props because she thinks of the character, right? And she's just like, okay, I'm going to go, what is my character wearing? What is the brand want? What is the brand's what are the brand's values? Like, what kind of person uses the brand? And so she starts to develop a character within the context of that. Then that helps her bring into play her props. Again, she starts thinking about the plot, the storyline. Again, this is super technical, but at the same time, super simple. It's just a thought, like no one might even see this. You don't need to put, okay, these are the plots, this is the plot storyline. You don't need to spell it out for your audience or for the brand. But when you let them into that, you can let them into that process. But when you actually process it like that, you have a clear arc that I think like adds to it. And so you got your plot storyline. You're like, okay, this person is sitting. And it's simple things, right? Like this is so interesting. It could just be this person is sitting outside having a picnic, or it could be this person is sitting outside waiting on her lover to show up to a picnic. Yeah. Like, that changes the mood. That little detail will change the mood of the shoot in so many ways. Like, she's anticipating her lover, you know? Yeah. Like what is the vibe of that on camera? And then again, like, thinking through that process and then thinking about technique. All right, where is my camera? What are the best angles? Right. What's the shot size? Like, it's probably not gonna be super close up if you wanna show a wide of you or a mid shot of you using the product or like engaging with the picnic for this example. So I think that's something that all content creators, whether you're working in a collaborative setting or by yourself, you should be processing like this to help you tell more effective stories.
Oh, absolutely. And have you ever, came across a situation where you've bid for a project with a client or potential client, and then, you know, there's been other creators that have been up for the job as well, so in a sense you're competing against them, and then they chose you based on the detail in your brief?
Yeah, absolutely. And I think a good example of that was with Saudi Arabia. With Saudi Arabia, there were a few people that reached out to take over their content creation, and they just kind of sent them an Instagram message and just went, hey, like, I think it'd be really good if we could collaborate because XXX, and these are my numbers and whatever. And now, like, as a growing creator and with the Win Collective, we don't have the greatest amount, like, numbers, but that worked, I think, in our favor because as we didn't start with focusing on numbers, it allowed us to focus on honing in our creativity. And so we became more interested in the storytelling process than focusing on the numbers. And those things will come, you know, like, you attract the right audience if you can, like, hone in your creativity. And so when we reached out to Saudi, we started with Instagram, which is an amazing tool for reaching out to brands. Yeah. I literally went into their DMs. I was like, hey, I see you doing this, and I think you could do this better. I'd love to show you how, if that's okay. And they were just like, sure, send us an email. I was like, okay, I'll send you an email. I'll do one step further. I'll send you a brief, you know? And so I went in and we created this brief for this project that we really believed in. Again, I don't think you need to know certain things. Like, is your client looking for creators? Are they looking for briefs? Like, I think you have to think about this stuff so that you don't spend all your time and all your resources pouring into a project that you may not get, right? Which I think can often be the case. So we just made sure that, okay, that's something that they were actually interested in. We put together this brief. It was for a project called The Saudi I Know. We knew that they were engaging influencers. Again, it's about knowing the brand, looking at the brand. So we knew they were engaging influencers. We knew that they wanted to share the perspective of what Saudi actually is like through the eyes of people traveling there. And so we put together this brief for this project called The Saudi I Know, where we would have influencers share about the elements of the Saudi that they discovered. And we put together this brief, sent it over, and it was accepted. We were in Saudi like a month later. And then we went on to win a contract with them where we now look after all of their video content for a year. So
amazing. That's incredible to go from sliding into the DMs on Instagram and then to winning a year contract. Yeah. Then.
It's honestly, like, it's amazing.
Mind blown.
Yeah.
So now, I mean, you're working with a team. I mean, what did it take for you to build, you know, the team that you work with now? And especially for those that, you know, content creators who are looking to start to scale a bit more.
Yeah. I think collaboration is super important. And for, in complete honesty, like, my strength is definitely more like activating and ideation. I get really demotivated or like not energized with the particular details. I love this process of visualizing beforehand because then it allows me to do what I like energizes me, which is ideate. But where you need to start collaborating is when you notice, okay, there's something that could be done better if delegated, you know? And you start to value that creator because you're going, okay, you can add something here that I think would be better than if I tried to add it. So for example, my working relationship with Barney. Barney is an amazing cinematographer. He shoots most of the Win Collective projects. And so our process is I'll start ideating, bringing these ideas together. I'll send it over to Barney, who then works more on the like technical side and like working that out. And then we're both on set, like bringing our ideas together and pulling that for a shoot. So I think the first step with that, and I think I can base it on how I work with Barney or with the creators within the Win Collective, is reaching out. Like, honestly, like the worst they're gonna say is no. And to be honest, like I think if you reach out, not just to get something, but with adding value, like some of my favorite creators are amazing visual storytellers that wanna tell better stories and wanna include things like voiceovers or scripts. And it takes me really like less time as a writer to put together a script or a voiceover and to record it and send it over to enhance or add value to their project. Because in another setting or scene, I might want something from them or something that I believe could enhance my project, and they're going to be more inclined to do it because I added value to their project. So I think it starts with wanting to collaborate, but adding value. I think when you try to bring a team around you, but without adding value to them, that's where it starts going wrong. That's where you start having people that are in the project for specifically or only for money or monetary gain. Whereas if you go, all right, this is the vision, this is how it adds value to everyone involved, then people are like, and then you give people ownership over particular sections. Like, I don't get involved with like the technical just to have, so that Barney can have his own space, you know, like he owns that, you know, like that's his thing. I don't want, like, even if I have an opinion, like, of course there's feedback and all that stuff that we can give, and there's a healthy way to do that. But I think when you're collaborating, like, own your part, do your part to the best, and allow people to have that ownership over their part. And so when you collaborate together, which I think is so necessary within like Instagram community or just content creation, like, people actually can bring their best to the table and you can have a more successful project.
I just want to thank you so much for joining us today, skill sharing, and teaching us all how to level up and taking us, you know, into the behind the scenes of your creative process, because you're so multifaceted in your skill set. So it was really nice to see it in a visual way and then have you talk us through it. Really, really powerful stuff.
Honestly, thanks for having me. I think School Days is amazing. And it's an amazing resource for just allowing, like, empowering content creators and empowering creators to create better, to collaborate. And it's amazing. So thank you so much for having me.
So Clay, we are asking creators if they've partnered up with a charity. So for those that are watching, you know that School Days is 100% free. It's, you know, just really valuable training, skill sharing. However, if you feel like you've learned something from this particular episode, we encourage you to donate or find a way to support the creators. Now, this particular creator, Clay here, actually does have a charity in mind. Clay, could you tell us a little bit more about this?
Yeah, so there's a charity, an initiative in Brazil actually right now, which is one of the hardest hit regions with COVID. They're called Acorda Capoeira. They exist within the Rocinha favela, which is one of the largest favelas in Brazil. And it's a psychosocial, like, extracurricular activity where they give kids access to education initiatives and also, like, teach them capoeira as a means of, like, engaging them in sport and creativity and music. And I think it's really important now more than ever, sorry, while the economy has been, like, hit in Brazil, to come behind these people and support these guys. We looked into a story, which is linked on my profile as well, about Paulo, one of the guys that came through that program, amazing, who talks about how this program helped to lure him away from the prospect of crime and becoming a criminal or, like, doing whatever you need to do to make money. But I think a lot of people right now within the program, kids, their families are being affected by the virus and by the economy, or the state of the economy with the virus. So if there's anything you can do to help, if you want Paulo's story to kind of, like, really understand what the project is, please feel free to go and check it out. And if you can help, we'd love that.
That would be amazing. Thank you. And again, guys, we definitely encourage you to give. Giving is not compulsory, but in times like this, where the world is struggling through collective loss, the spirit of giving is highly appreciated. So again, thanks so much for sharing that with us, Clay. And, you know, we're going to go ahead and close out the program, but we just wanted to say thank you to you and to everyone that tuned in for this particular episode. We just want to say thank you from School Days, where we talk to creators about the creative process and get that really in-depth behind the scenes and learn things along with them in their tutorial. So next week, we have a brand new episode dropping. You do not want to miss that. We are so, so, so excited about that one. But we just want to say thank you so much from School Days, and we'll see you later.
Thank you.